Good afternoon. I'm Ruby with the American Lung Association in Minnesota, and welcome to the 2016 Asthma Webinar Series. Thank you to United Health Foundation for supporting this webinar series, and a special welcome to our United Health Foundation partners and Asthma Action Coalitions joining us across the Upper Midwest. Before we get started, we have a few housekeeping items to cover. One, all of your lines are muted. If you have a question during the presentation, please use the chat box function in the lower right-hand corner, and we'll address those at the end. Secondly, a copy of the recording of today's webinar will be shared with all of you, and please feel free to forward that along to colleagues. And lastly, we invite you to register for our two scheduled upcoming webinars, and we will include links to those in a follow-up email. And now I would like to welcome Marcy Ballman, who will be discussing air quality in wood stove homes. Marcy received her bachelor's degree with a major in neuroscience and earned her PhD in toxicology from the University of Montana's Center for Environmental Health Sciences. Her PhD work involved evaluating exposures of asthmatic children living in homes with wood stoves, and her research involved implementing and evaluating the efficacy of in-home interventions aimed at improving the child's quality of life. She's currently the Health Program Manager for American Lung Association in Montana. Thank you for joining us today, and I will hand it over to Marcy.
Thanks so much, Ruby. I hope everybody can hear me. This is Marcy Ballman. I am with the American Lung Association of the Mountain Pacific, working, as Ruby said, in Montana. So today we'll be talking about improving indoor air quality in wood stove homes. So Ruby already gave a great introduction to me, and I appreciate that, Ruby. So a little bit on my background, I do have 9 years experience in indoor air quality. I've worked in both residential and occupational indoor air quality. And my dissertation from the University of Montana, as Ruby said, was focusing on indoor particulate matter exposures for asthmatic children living in homes with wood stoves. A lot of the data that you'll see today came from the publications resulting from that work, as well as two publications that are pending from that work as well. And my current project in Montana is the Enhancing Care for Children with Asthma through the American Lung Association, primarily focused on primary care clinics and their work with pediatric asthma. So my goal today is that by the end, everybody will be well-versed about what it is about wood smoke that contributes to poor indoor air quality, how it exacerbates asthma, and that you guys will have a strong understanding for intervention strategies to improve this air quality that are both practical and cost-effective. So that's the goal for today. So I'll just briefly touch on childhood asthma since this Special Considerations in Asthma webinar series. I'm sure everyone's fairly familiar. But just briefly, asthma is a chronic disease characterized by reversible airway obstruction, airway hyperresponsiveness, and eosinophilic inflammation. So basically what you're getting is that trifecta of muscle tightening, inflammation, and mucus restricting breathing in the airways. Prevalence of asthma, especially pediatric asthma, has drastically increased in the past several decades. A lot of that is thought to be due to the hygiene hypothesis and kind of these hypersensitivity diagnoses that are increasing nationwide, as well as an increase in the awareness of asthma and proper diagnosis, where maybe previously it was diagnosed as reactive airway disease or twitchy lungs. Now children are receiving a formal diagnosis of asthma. The cost of asthma in the U.S. is enormous. There's estimated to be over 6 million children with asthma. This table shows the breakdown of the total population and then pediatric asthma cases and adult asthma cases based on American Lung Association region. What you'll see is that, you know, it's in the millions. This translates to almost 2 million emergency room visits every year for children with asthma, over 10 million missed school days, and as you can imagine, between healthcare costs, missed school, missed work for the parents of these children, consumes over $2 billion annually in the United States. So indoor air quality is a topic that is near and dear to my heart as I've spent so much time working on it, but it's really relevant to people's environmental exposures as a whole because it's been found and determined that people spend about 90% of their time indoors. Sleeping overnight indoors, you drive to work, you work all day indoors, that's the majority of where your exposures are going to come from. There are a number of factors in the home that can contribute to poor indoor air quality. Their outdoor air can infiltrate into indoor air and contribute in that way, but a lot of what you're being exposed to in your home originates in your home. For asthmatics, the concerns are allergens such as pests and dust mites, and then other triggers that can include chemicals, food fumes, tobacco smoke, and then of course pollen and mold and mildew that can be in the home. So what we're going to talk about today is about the contributions of wood stoves to poor indoor air quality and what we can do to control those exposures. So a lot of people have the general assumption that wood smoke is natural. Humans have been burning wood for a very long time, and so it doesn't have any toxic effects. But really, for people with pre-existing lung diseases and sensitivities like asthma, it can really be a negative aspect on their health. Globally, there's a huge impact on what household air pollution from solid fuels, how it contributes to what makes us sick. So this is just kind of a fancy epidemiological way of looking at what makes us sick worldwide. And what you'll see is that this chart is showing disability-adjusted life years, or what's also called dailies, which is the number of years lost due to ill health, disability, or early death. And worldwide, we see that household air pollution from burning of solid fuels or biomass fuels is fourth on the list for what makes us sick. And what contributes to that are cardiovascular and circulatory disease issues, respiratory disease issues, and then there's lower respiratory infections. So globally, biomass smoke is a huge deal. Studying it within the United States is less of a life or death issue, except for when it comes to really severe asthma attacks. So looking at what's in wood smoke and what makes it toxic, I really like this table and also dislike this table at the same time, but I think it's really interesting to see that wood smoke contains many of the same components as known respiratory irritants, diesel emissions, and tobacco smoke. The toxicologist in me where the red flag comes up is that the dose makes the poison, and the majority of these toxicants are nowhere near the concentration in wood smoke as they are in diesel emissions and tobacco smoke, but they are in there. And so where you really get the chronic exposures are the low dose, long term, over time, over many, many years of your life, versus diesel emissions and tobacco smoke. You get that in a wood smoke home. And particulate matter, the one second from the bottom, or PM, has been found to be the main exposure of interest for those studying wood smoke and health-related exposures. And so I'll talk a bunch about particulate matter today. The health effects that we see from biomass burning, and when I say biomass, it can kind of be all-encompassing. For the most part, with wood stoves, we're really talking about wood. But even nationally across the United States, regionally, there's a lot of differences in the type of wood people burn. Here in Montana, we really only have access to soft woods such as pine and larch, so that's what people are burning. But in other areas where there's access to hardwood, people are more typically burning that because it burns a little bit better. But biomass can also include burning hay, burning straw, and places in the world where they burn cow patties. It really can be anything biological material. So burning of this material has shown relationships with general irritation with soft tissue, so burning eyes, nausea, and headaches. Obviously respiratory issues, especially asthma attacks and chronic bronchitis for those with underlying respiratory issues. And then the same cardiovascular issues that we see with urban particulate air pollution, so things that have a more industrial source. When you have a bad air pollution day in a large metropolitan area, you'll see an increase in the amount of emergency department emissions for heart problems. And so the same particulate matter is causing the same issues with biomass burning. And ultimately, when it's all said and done, it contributes to the premature death in people with lung or heart disease. So the United States Department of Energy has estimated that there's upwards of 11.6 million homes in the United States that use wood as a primary or secondary heating fuel. There's a lot of reasons for this. It's not always just ambiance. Sometimes it's out of necessity. Here in Montana, there are large majorities of the state where there's not a natural gas line where people can just pipe in and get into the natural gas. So they need to either have a freestanding propane tank if they want to use gas to heat their home, or they can use wood, and those are really their only options. A study done by Tony Ward and Curtis Noonan, who are my former advisors at the University of Montana here in Missoula, published a paper in 2015 estimating that of these 11.6 million homes, there's about 3 million children living in homes with wood stoves. So if we correlate that out to that 1 in 10 children with asthma assumption, then we can be looking at upwards of 300,000 children with asthma in the United States living in a home with a wood stove. And in semi-urban to very rural environments, which encompasses almost the entire state of Montana, but a lot of areas across the country as well, wood smoke can account for up to 90% of the ambient or outdoor particulate matter concentrations. So we know that it's out there. It's the majority of the pollutant that's happening, especially here in Montana, outdoors. So what we want to know is what's going on indoors, since people spend about 90% of their time indoors. This is a great visual of how the emissions come from the different types of wood-burning stoves. On the left, you'll see the dirtiest or very dirty wood-burning fireplace, and this is referring to outdoor air pollution as well, so what's coming out the chimney. We have an uncertified and EPA-certified wood stove, so getting slightly cleaner, and I'll talk a little bit more about EPA-certified wood stoves later on. And then pellet stoves have a little bit less emissions, going all the way down to electric heat. I always mention with this slide that the caveat of having clean electric heat and no pollution is as long as you don't live downwind from the coal-burning power plant that's generating the electricity. So it's just keeping in mind these are just local emissions coming directly from your heat source. So as I mentioned before, particulate matter, or PM, is the main exposure of interest when we're looking at wood smoke exposure. This is a great picture showing an electron micrograph of a human hair. So the average human hair in diameter is 70 micrometers across. Micrometer is 1/1,000,000th of a meter, so it's 10 to the minus 9. So this is very, very small. Zoomed in on a human hair, we see a bunch of these coarse fraction particles, which fall into PM10. Here it says PM10 to 2.5. Those numbers after the PM just have to, they just describe the size of the particles that we're talking about. So PM10 to 2.5 is between 10 and 2.5 micrometers across. So those are how many particles would fit across the diameter of an average human hair. And then there's PM 2.5, also called fine particles, even smaller. And then zooming in on one of those, you see these ultra-fine particles, which research has really exploded in that field in the past several years. You may have heard of PM10 and PM 2.5 before, as they are both criteria air pollutants regulated by the EPA. So there can be outdoor air sheds that are considered non-attainment for those. PM 2.5 is generally considered to be more of an urban source with combustion from vehicles and industrial sources, where larger PM10 tends to be more agricultural dust, larger particles. It tends to be high in cities as well, but PM 2.5 typically is more urban. Now, getting to the topic of the day with coarse particles or particulate matter from wood smoke, coarse particles have some really unique properties that I'll talk about in the next few slides that make them very interesting to study, especially with biomass burning. So this picture here is from a fire that's actually still ongoing about 50 miles south of Missoula. It's called the Roaring Lion Fire, and it started and blew up into over 2,000 acres within 12 hours, and it's currently burning at about 3,500 acres. They're thinking that it's going to take a season-ending event, which in Montana is other words for snowfall, to end this fire. So coarse particles captured during wildfire activity, so from the outdoor air, during a wildfire have shown more pro-inflammatory and oxidative stress potential on an equal dose basis than fine particles. Basically, what this means is a study was done in California during a wildfire where they captured particles and separated them by size, exposed them to some cells, and the cells that were exposed to the larger particles had more pro-inflammatory and oxidative stress mediators than the fine. So there's something about these larger particles, the composition of them, in biomass smoke that makes them potentially more toxic and cause more pro-inflammatory issues in people with asthma. What they've determined that it is, I kind of jumped right to it in the next slide, are these bioaerosols. So the coarse fraction has 10 times more biological content than the fine fraction, than that PM2.5. Bioaerosols, the name kind of gives it all away. It's biological material that's aerosolized in the air. So what you get is a mixture of these solid or liquid particles in the air that kind of bind to all different types of particles containing whole or parts of biological material. As you can imagine, these can be a pretty strong respiratory irritant or allergen trigger to people with asthma. In the lab, these things are quantified via colony-forming units or CFUs. Ergosterol and beta-glucan are both fungal markers. And endotoxin I'll talk a lot about because of its strong association with asthma in the indoor environment. Endotoxin is a component of the cell wall of gram-negative bacteria. It's also called lipopolysaccharide, or LPS. And then you can also quantify bioaerosols in the air with total protein, kind of indiscriminately looking how much protein is in the air. So where things really get interesting, having to do with bioaerosols and wood smoke air, this study is actually from general air without a wildfire activity going on, but it's just such a genius way of showing that without the biological content, it's not size specific, the reason that these particles are just a little bigger and therefore they're a little more toxic, it's really what the composition of them is. So what we're seeing here is the results from this study in 2006 at Chapel Hill, and what they found was collecting particles from outdoor air and exposing healthy adult volunteers, so these were not asthmatics, and they were looking at TNF-alpha, which is a major inflammatory mediator in the immune system, and they exposed them to control on the left. In the middle is just the ambient air of the coarse particles untreated, and then they took a group of these particles and heat treated them, essentially sterilizing them and removing all of the biological content or making it biologically inactive. And what they found is that the ambient air, the middle black bar, had a significant increase in this TNF-alpha, this inflammatory mediator. And when you heat treated that air or sterilized it, that significant increase was blunted or, you know, brought back to a non-significant level. So the conclusion that they can draw from that is that biological inactivation reduces this inflammatory potential. So we know that the coarse fraction has a much higher biological content than the fine fraction, and we know if we can get rid of that biological content, we get rid of that inflammatory potential. So it's not just a size of particle issue. So endotoxin, again, that lipopolysaccharide or LPS, has for many years been known and accepted as a risk factor for asthma, asthma severity, asthma symptoms, things of that nature. These four charts here are from Peter Thorne's group, published in 2005 in the Journal of Respiratory and Critical Care Medicine. Peter Thorne has studied endotoxin for decades and is really an expert. He's out of Iowa. But what we see is that as endotoxin concentrations increase in homes, and this was measured in dust samples in homes, and we'll talk a little bit in a little bit about the difference between measuring in dust and what's actually airborne. But measuring in dust, the increases, we see an increase in the rate of diagnosed asthma, asthma symptoms, asthma medication use, and wheeze prevalence. So endotoxin presence in the home is clearly associated with all of these measures of asthma severity. And there are in-home predictors that have been studied and determined to predict the number, the amount of endotoxin in a home. And they're kind of some things you'd expect. The number of people in the home, the The more people that there are, the more skin cells are shedding and bacteria there is and breath and all of that. Presence of pets is a predictor of how much endotoxin is in a home. And then dampness and moisture sources, so that comes into a mold and mildew issue. So all of these things predict endotoxin in the home. Now, globally, just to tie it all back in with what's going on globally and the real global burden of disease, is that airborne endotoxin concentration in homes burning biomass fuels in developing countries are orders of magnitude higher than those found in homes in developed countries. This picture is a great illustration of a lot of more traditional biomass burnings. This is from an open access book published in 2015 on indoor air quality and risk factors in Nigeria. And so you can see why lower respiratory infections have been identified as one of the top mortality causes in children under the age of 5 worldwide, because here they are in a home sick with smoke all day, cooking and things like that. As far as what's considered a healthy concentration of bioaerosols in homes or in occupational settings, there haven't been any definitive answers. There's no guidelines by OSHA. There's nothing by the World Health Organization saying what's good and what's bad. The only thing that's been published is a health-based guidance limit. So again, this is something that isn't enforced, just the guidance limit of 50 EUs, which is endotoxin units, which is the way that they're measured. So 50 endotoxin units per meter cubed of air for an 8-hour time-weighted average. And this came out of an occupational guideline in the Netherlands. So just as an idea of what is considered quote-unquote healthy over an 8-hour period. If any of you are going into homes or working with people who have wood stoves and have questions, a big concern that we've seen a lot of is, you know, if they're pregnant or have a young child, the worry about developing asthma if they have a wood stove in their homes. There have been no studies that have linked wood stoves and asthma development. That's not to say that there's been any negative results. The studies just have not been done because, if you can imagine, that's a birth to, you know, maybe puberty length type study, where you're trying to see if there's a risk identified with having a wood stove for developing asthma or not developing asthma. So what's really been studied is knowing that wood smoke exacerbates asthma. So if there's a child that is living in the home that already has asthma, we know we need to try to control their indoor exposures from the wood stove to control that trigger for them. So these pictures are from Dr. Tony Ward, my former advisor at the university, and they really just give a general idea of what we see in homes here in Western Montana with the wood smoke sometimes coming out of a side chimney, sometimes at the top of the house, and then the picture of just a conventional wood stove, non-EPA certified wood stove. So the intervention strategies that we're going to look at today for improving indoor air quality in wood stove homes are tried and true indoor air quality interventions. And what's been studied and identified in the past is that every dollar spent on home-based multi-component interventions for asthma have a monetary savings of between $5 and $14. So that's why these studies are funded, and that's why all these programs exist, is because it's been shown and proven that going into homes and making changes to improve the indoor air quality increases the child's or the asthmatic's quality of life, saves them money on healthcare problems, saves them money from missing school and work and all of those things together. So the two major schools of thought, and they're not mutually exclusive really, but looking at the past strategies that have been done to how do we reduce indoor wood smoke exposure, how do we reduce people's wood smoke exposure, are through wood stove changeout programs and through the use of air filters in the home. So we'll talk about both of those today and kind of their pros and cons. So wood stove changeout programs have been really promoted by the Environmental Protection Agency, and they're reminding people that if you're going to be changing out your wood stove and replacing it for any reason, the new one that you buy, you should look for one that is EPA certified. How the EPA certifies a wood stove is they're looking at the emissions that come out of the chimney per certain amount of wood that they burn per hour. So basically what you're looking at is just a reduction of the amount of particulate and the smoke that's coming out the chimney. This has to do with efficiency. So there's a bunch of different kind of statistics on this slide that come from different places. But the EPA is saying that these certified stoves are 50% more energy efficient than non-certified stoves. The reason for that is because they're using less wood to provide the same amount of heat, on average about a third less wood if they're following proper burn procedures. There really should be little to no smoke. What they say is that when you go buy a house that is burning their EPA certified wood stove, you shouldn't even be able to see smoke coming out of the chimney. That's how little particulates are being emitted. Because of this, it also decreases the amount of creosote buildup, which is great because creosote is very dangerous for chimney fires. And the overall goal, and because the EPA is obviously focused on the outdoor environment, is that these stoves are decreasing outdoor air pollution by 70%. Now, I started this presentation by saying that people spend about 90% of their time indoors. So while it's important to improve outdoor air quality in general because it can infiltrate into the indoor air, we also want to know how do these stoves, the old inefficient stoves and EPA certified stoves, how do they contribute to indoor air quality and how can we mitigate those exposures from an indoor source? So my main work with my dissertation at the University of Montana was with ARTIST, the ARTIST program, which is an acronym that stands for ASTMA, a randomized trial of indoor smoke. And it's a placebo-controlled randomized trial looking at improving the quality of life of asthmatic children living in homes with wood stoves through indoor air quality interventions. So if you look at the winter one line, where we're getting baseline exposures and health outcome measures. We recruited a bunch of homes with children with asthma. The first winter didn't do anything in terms of intervention. We're just getting what their exposures are. The health outcome measures, we relied heavily on the pediatric asthma quality of life questionnaire, as well as several other asthma-specific questionnaires. We also did collect some biological material to look at mediators of inflammation from the children. We collected urine and we collected exhaled breath condensate, which is a really neat way of having a child breathe into a cold tube that condenses their breath into a liquid, and you can then analyze that liquid for all kinds of good stuff. But prior to the second winter, the homes were randomized to receive one of three interventions. The first being an EPA-certified wood stove, so that's a full-blown wood stove replacement. The second being that the homes would receive active air filter units. We used one that's actually no longer on the market from 3M called a Filtreat, but really similar to what you see out there with Honeywell and some other brands, kind of the same idea. And these homes received a unit for their living room as well as the children's bedroom. The third arm of the treatment groups was the placebo arm. So they received an inactive air filter unit, which I'll talk a little bit in the next slide about what the placebo filters look like. So they still received filters, but we considered them placebo filters in order to blind the participants to their treatment group. So obviously, the people who received the wood stove changeout knew what treatment group they were in, but between the active and placebo filters, or filter unit groups, they wouldn't know. And then after we gave them those interventions, we would measure all of the same exposure and health outcome measures to see if there are any changes across winters. Just to show a little bit of what equipment we use to measure the exposures, we're looking at the particles in a number of different ways. We used a particle counter from a company called Lighthouse, a TSI dust track, which is commonly used for PM2.5. Both of those instruments are digital, so you're not actually collecting any particles. You're just getting data to download in the lab to analyze. And then when I joined the research group, we added on the CPEM, which stands for Coarse Particulate Environmental Monitor, and that collected that coarse fraction actually on filters. So then we were able to take those filters into the lab and not only know how much of the coarse fraction was there, but we were able to extract the filters and determine how much endotoxin was in the home as well. And then we also had a TSIQ track looking at temperature, relative humidity, and other indoor air quality measures. So these placebo versus active filters, this is where things start to get really interesting to interpreting the results. So these filters are rated based on this MERV scale. MERV stands for Minimum Efficiency Reporting Value. And the higher you get, the better these filters get at filtering things out, and consequently, the more expensive they get. So the placebo filters, and as I mentioned, the homes received these placebo filters so that they were blinded to whether or not they had a filter or a quote-unquote active filter or not. These filters run typically less than a dollar. They're normally used for general furnace filters. They're quantified as being able to remove particles larger than 10 micrometers, so larger than those coarse fraction particles, where all kinds of construction dust and larger pollen and dust might fall into. Now, the active filters that we used for the intervention had a MERV rating of 13, which are 90% effective down to the sub 1 micrometer range, so should filter out the majority of that PM 2.5 and coarse fraction as well. This is like a HEPA grade, not technically HEPA classified, but HEPA grade filter. They usually come in a 2 or 3 pack for $20 or $30. So doing some recent Amazon searches of the types of filters just earlier this week, we're looking at about $9.16 per filter. So there's a real financial difference between these placebo and active filters. And that'll be a little bit more important when we look at the results. So this is data that I grabbed from a much more data-intensive table from a current publication from my previous research group in the Journal of Exposure Science and Environmental Epidemiology. So I just grabbed these kind of real quick descriptive statistics showing the results of the study. So the wood stove changeout, as expected, is a very expensive intervention. We're talking between $2,500 and $4,500 per home when you talk about getting a certified person to remove the old wood stove and install the EPA-certified wood stove. Some of the homes needed chimney repairs, hearth replacement, things of that nature. It's very expensive. And in the initial winters of doing this artist program, which was rolling enrollment, so we had some homes start each winter over time, what we were seeing was a really variable and inconsistent impact on indoor PM 2.5 from these wood stove replacements. And so this graph here, taken from 16 homes that received the wood stove replacement, these are the pre-intervention and post-intervention medians. And so on average, we only saw about a 9% reduction in PM 2.5 in those homes. Now compare that to the homes that received the filters, active filters, and the homes that received the placebos. Looking at the PM 2.5 in micrograms per cubic meter, you can see that the filter homes work extremely well for a much less expensive cost and significantly reduce PM 2.5 in the homes. So what this ended up doing was, some interim analysis of this study, the wood stove intervention was dropped because we didn't feel it was a good use of the grant funding and was also not performing as we hoped to improve PM 2.5. So subsequent years of this study randomized the homes with the asthmatic children into just a filter or placebo group and not the wood stove group, which is why this graph has 16 wood stove homes and then 42 filter homes and 40 placebo homes. Now, when we look at the difference between the active filter versus the placebo in reducing particulate matter, this was one of the more interesting findings of the study in terms of the air quality. What we saw is we're looking at pre-intervention and post-intervention, and these are the coarse fraction on the left and the fine fraction on the right, measured in micrograms per cubic meter. What we see is that the coarse fraction is reduced by the placebo filter and the active filter. So the placebo filter is actually significantly reducing by 41% the coarse fraction in the air. Now, PM 2.5, on the other hand, was reduced by the active filter by significantly 70%, but not by the placebo. So one of the main conclusions of this study, unexpected and wonderful, is that this placebo filter, this inexpensive placebo filter, reduces the coarse fraction. Although it doesn't reduce PM 2.5, it does reduce that coarse fraction significantly. So Although we know that PM 2.5 is also an asthma trigger and we want to try to reduce that in the home, as far as a cost-effective measure, these filters are 10 to 20 times cheaper, and now we know they reduce the coarse fraction. So the next question is, how about that endotoxin within the coarse fraction? Is that equally reduced? And that is exactly what we see in these homes, is that the placebo filter reduces endotoxin significantly by 73% and 80% in the two measures of endotoxin. So on the left is looking at endotoxin units per milligram of the actual airborne particles collected. And then on the right, the 80% reduction by the placebo filter to reduce endotoxin units per volume of air, so calculating how much air was actually pulled through the filters within the coarse fraction. And then the active filter, as expected, also significantly reduces endotoxin at a higher percentage, but all of these reductions were still significant. So I want to mention to anyone out there who's noticing differences in pre-intervention concentrations from the wood stove and placebo and active filter homes. We did find that the homes that were randomized to the wood stove group did have a higher baseline concentrations of PM 2.5, but it wasn't significant, and with a lot of sensitivity analyses, we determined that it didn't influence the results at all. It was just kind of a per chance result of the randomization, so just in case anybody noticed that. And so in summary of these air filter interventions is that these inexpensive, what we considered a kind of quote-unquote placebo filter, actually worked very well to reduce airborne endotoxin as significantly as the HEPA-grade filters. Now, these HEPA-grade filters were required to see a significant reduction in the PM 2.5, so those coarser, lower MERV value filters didn't reduce PM 2.5 as well as the advanced HEPA-grade filters. Now where we get into the health effects, which these results are still kind of coming out, and we have a publication pending in Environmental Health Perspectives, so hopefully we'll get some peer-reviewed responses here soon and get that finalized and published. But the main finding that we found with the health effects is that among these asthmatic children chronically exposed to wood smoke, a simple in-home air filter intervention was efficacious for reducing DPFV, which stands for diurnal peak flow value, and it's an indicator of airway hyperreactivity. One of the other health measures we performed for these children when we were monitoring their air quality was we gave them a peak flow meter called a picometer and had them record their PEF and FEV values in the morning, every morning and every evening for 2 weeks. Now what we're looking at with this diurnal peak flow variability is how much does their peak flow vary from evening to morning, and this is an established indicator of hyperreactivity. So even with only 40 homes in the filter group versus 40 homes in the placebo group, a relatively small study, to see a significant reduction in this indicator of airway hyperreactivity by reducing wood smoke PM 2.5 is wonderful. So I always want to include a slide on best burn practices when I talk about biomass burning. The best thing you want to advise people who have wood stoves in their home, asthmatic or not, is to keep a clean stove and chimney for the best optimal operation of their chimney. To use dry wood, so aged wood, at least a year, this wood burns hotter and therefore produces less particulate matter, so that'd be indoors and outdoors. And also to maintain smoke and carbon monoxide detectors, since biomass burners can produce both of those things, we want to be able to make sure that they're not getting too high in the home. The EPA has a great program called BurnWise and website there that has a whole bunch of other best burn practices. And so I included a few more slides here at the end where if I thought I had a few minutes, I would breeze through these, because I realize some of you may live in areas where maybe biomass burning in residential locations is not very common. But what we're seeing is that the number of wildfires larger than 100,000 acres in size that burn each year are growing exponentially. This is a result of climate change. It's a frequency and the size and the duration of fires, of wildfires, has just gone crazy in the past decades. So we're seeing fires start sooner, we're seeing bigger fires, and we're seeing just major effects, health effects from these particles. And especially as urban areas encroach on some more rural areas where there's availability of wildfires for burning, the number of people that are going to be exposed to biomass smoke and particulate matter in the next decade is only going to increase. Here's a look of what data looks like in Montana across several years. So this data is very old, going on 15 years old, but it's still relevant. What you see is a general increase in the wintertime and decrease in the summertime. Increase in the wintertime, decrease in the summertime. That's because the majority of the particulate matter being measured here is coming from wood stoves. However, what you see in the summer of 2003 being circled is a big spike due to right near where the sampling site was in Libby, there was a large wildfire. So what you can imagine is as wildfires intensity and frequency increases, these high wintertime concentrations that normally go down in the summer are going to either stay higher or have higher frequency of higher concentrations in the summer due to these wildfires. Data collected, and these slides are from Tony Ward, so I thank him for his sharing of his slides. His group at the University of Montana last year did a quick comparison. Last year was a really bad fire year for anybody in the Northern Rockies. We were looking at concentrations, looking here at upwards of 400 micrograms per cubic meter, where the EPA standard for PM2.5 is 35 for a 24-hour period and 15 annually, so way down at the bottom of the graph is where we should be. But what this is looking at is simultaneous measurement of PM2.5 outdoor in blue and indoor in red. And it shows that 75% of this ambient particulate matter is measured indoors. So as important as it is to control the indoor air quality from indoor sources, we want to keep in mind these major events that cause huge outdoor concentrations can impact indoors as well. I included a picture from last year where the University of Montana football team decided to continue with their first game of the year despite really poor air quality from wildfire smoke. And for those of you who have not had the pleasure of experiencing a nice smoky day in Montana, that's what it looks like. So there are guidelines from the EPA as well as regional things in Montana and Missoula. There's all kinds of websites and hotlines and advisories for activities for people to have during wildfire smoke. This is also really important to keep in mind for school-age children that are participating in sports. And what to do when there are poor air quality days from wildfire or other reasons. So with that, I'll be happy to take any questions. I did see one question come up that I guess I could just jump on right now. Have you seen studies linking smoke from outdoor wood boilers to adverse indoor exposures? I haven't seen any specific studies using those. However, just anecdotally, the University of Montana was planning to go to primarily an outdoor wood boiler for all of their heat, and they were promoting it as this green source of energy and all these great things, and utilizing the local timber industry, and there was a bunch of blowback because it turned out that the smokestack was not tall enough to get the PM2.5 off campus, and so we would have just been inundating the campus with biomass smoke. So since we've seen the studies where we know that large wildfire events can infiltrate indoor air really thoroughly, I would imagine it'd be the same for hydronic heaters. Okay, so Felicia has a question about, is it best to not have a wood stove at all? That is just sometimes not an option. I mean, best case scenario, if you can get someone burning natural gas in their home or propane, that is going to have a lot less of that particulate matter. You have kind of some other risks as well with those, particularly when you're burning gases, you have more nitrogen oxide issues. But really, having a wood stove is not necessarily a choice for a lot of people, especially in the Northern Rockies, where either economically or just where they live, there's not access to natural gas line, you know, or to get a propane tank would be tens of thousands of dollars. So it might be something to advise if there's an asthmatic living in the home that has a really, really hard time, and that maybe it'd be worth it, but it's not always a choice. Okay, let's see here. Rhonda is asking, any data around what changes are noted in spirometry, which is a true objective measure for obstruction? Sure. Looking at, so basically, our measures that we took looking at that diurnal peak flow variability, that's kind of what's the best word for that? A way to look into, it's not a medical way of analyzing their lung function. It's really kind of just a acceptable way to get a glimpse at what's going on in their lungs. I have not seen any studies about associating biomass smoke with true spirometry, clinical spirometry. However, again, I'm going to put another shout out to the University of Montana. They recently are getting their first round of published papers out. They have a new inhalation exposure facility where they are exposing healthy individuals to biomass smoke with the implications for wildland firefighter research. So they're looking at how the activity and brain function and decision-making ability of people who are being exposed to high concentrations over a short period of time of smoke, because that's what wildland firefighters are experiencing. So what kind of air filtration were the filters attached to? So how these filters worked were they're standalone units. You could go and buy them, you know, at any hardware store or big box store, and they just plugged into the wall, and they just had, you know, a fan that would pull the air through and push it through a filter and redistribute the air. So that's what we were using, and again, those filters were replaced monthly. What about the type of stove you could use to replace? Yeah, good question, Kathy. So this question is the type of stove in the study to replace using a pellet stove versus a high-efficiency stove. So the EPA-certified stoves are pretty high efficiency, and those are really the gold standard of what is out there. But in terms of pellet stoves, those have become more and more popular, and I showed in one of those first infographic that shows that pellet stoves are emitting a lot less out the chimney, so it kind of stands to reason that they could be emitting a lot less into the indoor air as well. But again, it's kind of a feasibility thing where pellet stoves tend to be more expensive or on the more expensive side depending on the wood stove you're thinking of replacing it with. So if you can afford to almost kind of upgrade to a pellet stove. The other thing about pellets and wood is that many people in these communities collect their own wood, and pellets you'd have to go and buy them yourself. So it's kind of a self-sufficiency issue, maybe an economic issue, with having a wood stove where you can produce your own fuel versus having to go to the store and buy fuel. I've heard that. Okay. Felicia's asking if outdoor air is worse than indoor air, especially in environments like Chicago, should we be advising our families to air out their places? So let me get back to the beginning. I would say it varies completely on the day and the city and what's going on about whether indoor air and what's going on in the indoor environment, whether outdoor air is going to be better than indoor air. I would say probably in Chicago there's chance that the outdoor air could be worse than the indoor air on days where you have, like, I don't know if you guys have smog there, but just high urban air pollution. But in the indoor air, depending on the building materials, how new your building is, if the, you know, what type of furnace it has, it's not necessarily true that outdoor air will always be worse than indoor air. If you're in a place that used green building materials and maybe has a nice air filter system, circulation system, then you can assume that the indoor air would be cleaner. Okay, I'm going to answer more shortly now so that I can answer these. Presence of endotoxins or bioaerosols for cordwood versus versus wildfire smoke. I haven't seen any of those studies, but it is when we're talking about different types of biomass, do have different concentrations of endotoxin. So I don't think there'd be a huge difference between cordwood or like dried wood versus wet wood. Where you really start to see the difference is when you go from burning wood to burning straw, to burning dung, to burning coal, all these different types of biomass fuels have varying concentrations of endotoxin. And what it, how it usually goes is that I don't want to get this backwards, but the more, well, I won't even say because I'm afraid to get it backwards, but so straw has higher than wood, and coal has lower than wood. So the scale goes from coal to wood to straw, dung having the highest. As you can imagine, there's a lot of biological material in there. Different types of particulate matter depending on the type of wood burn. That's a really good question. That is completely specific to the burning environment. So you can have a hardwood that you fresh cut down and burn it, and it's going to produce just as much particulate matter as a softwood that you just cut down. What the variables are as far as how much particulate matter there are is how hot that fire is burning, which is also a measure of how complete the combustion is. So the hotter the fire is burning, the more complete combustion there is, the less particles there are to escape into the smoke because they're burning and burning. Because the smoke and the ash that you collect really has flammable material on it. So if you could reburn it and keep reburning it and reburning it, that's why you're reducing the particulate matter that's coming off of the fire with more complete combustion. So I know in places where hardwood is accessible, they prefer to burn hardwood over softwood, whereas in Montana we don't have that option because there's not hardwood, but drying it and aging it is the best thing you're going to do for any type of wood. Impact of wildfire smoke for more short-term PM2.5 periods. I'm assuming that is like health-related short-term wildfire smoke exposure for like an occupational setting for wild and firefighters, or maybe having to do with just short-duration fires that aren't sticking around for hours and hours. I can't think of any in particular with that short of a duration, but again, that is brand new science that's coming out with exposures to higher concentrations for shorter periods of time to try to mimic that occupational exposure that wildland firefighters experience. We actually published a study while I was in the lab having to do with exposures at base camp, because wildland firefighters are based out of a base camp and then go from there to the active line. And the base camp is usually, you know, a few miles away, and they try to put it in an area that's not socked in with smoke. But we did a summer field trip all around the Pacific Northwest and then also down for a fire outside of San Luis Obispo in California, and found the majority of the fire camps we went to were very socked in with smoke. And that's where a lot of the higher up people who are making the decisions of where to send the wildland fighters, when to pull them out, that kind of decision making goes on in those camps. So there's a lot of really interesting future research to be done about how does that poor air quality from the wildfire smoke affect that decision-making ability when it is really some really important decisions to be made. So Felicia's saying that the ALA has an app for air quality. I'm not 100% sure. Does anyone else know that answer? Want to type it in?
I'm not actually sure if we do either. We can figure that out.
Okay. Thanks, Ruby. The app does show alerts in effect. State of the air. Nice. Okay. Thanks, Bev. Good deal. So that probably will show air quality advisories that are identified by those EPA monitoring sites of those criteria air pollutants. So the two classifications of particulate matter, PM10 and PM2.5, and sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, there's six criteria air pollutants. So.
All right, great. Any other questions out there? All right. Thank you, Marcy. That was awesome. If you have any other closing remarks, I'll let you get to those. I just wanted to tell everybody we will have a webinar September 15th and October 20th. The first is on asthma and anxiety with Pat Bass, and the second is actually on asthma education with Katie Jett. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.